Hello, and welcome to the Redesigning Wellness Podcast. I was recently online kind of searching around for things going on in the corporate wellness world and came across an article. And the article was about Pharos Systems, a company that had a wellness initiative that seemed a little bit unique. They included mindfulness, meditation, yoga, those type things. So I reached out to the person who was quoted in the article, Susy Bordin, and she is my guest today. Susy is outside of the profession. She has been working in business administration and project management for 25 years. And I always say, you know, throughout my career as a wellness professional, I've always needed to bring a project management skill set to my job because there's a million moving pieces and parts going on. When she got to Pharos, she began the corporate yoga program in late 2013, and then she launched the corporate wellness initiative in early 2015. She got to go to the Search Inside Yourself Google training in 2016, and she came back and kind of co-created the course to bring it to her coworkers in the organization. Susy continues to bring an enthusiastic and open approach to wellness at Pharos and plans to continue the program and really finding unique learning opportunities for herself and others. Now, Susy lives in Penfield, New York. Pharos is based in Rochester. With her partner, Joe, two teen daughters live in Aubrey, her teen stepdaughter, Bella, and of course, their cats and their dog, Harley, Quinn, and Ellie. You always have to mention the pets. I think it's very important. In this interview, Susy tells us about the company culture at Pharos and how she was really in disbelief, in a good way, when she started working there, a bit about what they have to offer as what I consider wellness perks, and how she built these offerings without having a background in wellness. And I also ask her, what's her advice for someone who has been tasked with running the wellness program who is a non-wellness professional? Now, I do want to say here that anytime I can find a company to highlight, I am so excited to do so. It thrills me to talk to people who love their job, and Susy's one of those people. I also want to talk about that, you know, we mention it in the podcast that they do have an incentive program, and that is handled out of HR, and Susy's outside of HR. And the incentive plan is for a HSA contribution. And, you know, it is, you guys know how I feel about incentive plans. But Susy has a really nice approach about it. It is very open, and there's a million different options that they can do. So I just want to, you know, go ahead and address it. Because many of you who listen regularly to me, you know, I talk about incentive plans and, you know, kind of the check in the box activities. And I do want to acknowledge that this is something we talk about and something Susy addresses. All right. So before we get started, of course, I want to mention my Facebook community. It is a private community where wellness professionals can, you know, put out a question, a new article, a discussion, a challenge, et cetera. In fact, there was someone going to a conference and they said, hey, is anyone else going? And a few people were. So they're meeting up together, which is pretty cool that the community is fostering that networking as well. So if you want to go join, then go to Facebook and under the groups section, just search for Redesigning Wellness Community. And I ask you two questions to prove that you are human and not a bot. And then I'll let you in. So come on in, join the conversation, contribute, and I'd love to see you there. All right, let's go ahead and dive into my interview with Susy Bordin of Pharos Systems. As always, thank you so much for listening to the Redesigning Wellness Podcast.
Hello and welcome to Redesigning Wellness, your go-to podcast for making the most of your corporate health strategies. Your host is Jen Arnold, corporate wellness consultant. With over a decade of experience in promoting worksite health, she'll help boost your wellness program to one your employees are sure to enjoy. And now, here's Jen.
Susy, welcome to the Redesigning Wellness Podcast. I'm so glad to have you.
Thank you. Thank you for having me on.
Yeah, tell us a little bit about Pharos and, you know, just what you do in your industry.
Well, Pharos is a software company. We focus on print management in medium to enterprise size organizations. And we help system administrators and leaders be mindful about how they use their resources as it pertains to print. And we have an overall goal of keeping their costs low, their documents secure, and their infrastructure safe. So That's what we've been doing for 25 years. And we're pretty small company in the grand scheme of things, Jen. There are about 130 of us. 68 of us are in Rochester, New York, which is just outside of Buffalo. 25 folks are remotely located around the United States. We've got a couple out, we've got one in Singapore, one in the UK, and then we have 35 folks in New Zealand, which is where we started from.
And, you know, we talked about on the pre-podcast chat how you really need to go get a work trip out to New Zealand.
I keep trying to come up with a really good project or a really good initiative that requires that I absolutely have to be there for at least 2 to 3 weeks during their summer months, for sure.
Yes, I was about to say, or in the winter months of Rochester.
Right. Like right now would be the ideal time to be in New Zealand.
Oh, yeah. They're opposite of us. So, yes.
Summer right now. Yeah. Yeah, it's nice.
What about your demographics, like male, female, like predominantly?
Great question. So here in Rochester, we have 20 female folks, staff, et cetera, in a handful of them in R&D, and then in sales. And then R&D still tends to be a heavily male-dominated industry. So a lot of our staff are male. We have a pretty middle age, if you will, staff. We hit somewhere between 43 and 46 as our medium. So we've got just out of college and millennials, and we have seasoned folks, so a little bit of everyone.
But let's talk about New Zealand. And so the company, you said that the company was founded in New Zealand, and the owners, you said Jeff and Paul, they've kind of set the tone or set the culture for the organization. So tell us more about that.
I'd love to. So when they started the company 25 years ago, they infused in their office and in their space the New Zealand culture. And it's rich in the spirit of acceptance and being open and truly focusing on the engagement and joy of the worker. If their mindset was, this is all about the people. And without the people, we don't have a Pharos. We don't have a company. So that's how they ran things in New Zealand for a number of years. And then when they came over to the US and they were moving the headquarters here, they sought out leadership. They sought out a CEO who shared in those same values. And they found him. They found our current CEO, Kevin, who really does honor, respect, and hold deeply the original New Zealand culture and values that were put in place.
And I know when we were talking before, you were saying you were almost shell-shocked by the culture when you, in a good way, right? And whenever you came to Pharos. So tell us a little bit about, because I think that just says a lot about the culture. I think people talk about culture all the time, or, you know, it's on the best places to work or this and that. But to be able to really experience a good culture, I think, is best told by the people within it that are maybe not the CEO telling the story, right? But someone who works there and has worked in other places before that maybe weren't as people focused.
Yeah, it's a great question. So when I came here, I had come from a completely different environment. It's a really small office. There's just a small handful of us. It was tough. It was emotionally unstable. You never quite knew what you were walking into on any given day. There was a true lack of trust as well, which was really challenging. You know, as a mother with two young children, and for those of us out there who have kids, they're unpredictable. They get sick a lot, especially in elementary school. And, you know, life doesn't stop, and you need to keep working, and you need to take care of your children. They need you. So I would have to work from home, and I had owned my own company for 12 years. So I have a pretty clear understanding of what it means to kind of knuckle down and ignore your surroundings and get your work done. And so I was used to that, but I found that when I was working from home on those days, there would be this intense level of distrust, and I would always have to go in and prove what I'd accomplished. And then when I was there, it was just this negative environment. And because of a bunch of changes with this small company, we agreed to part ways really amicably, which was great. And then Pharos came along. And it's interesting because when I saw the job opening, I reached out to an associate, and it had been a lot of years. And I said, "Do you know this CEO guy? Because is he decent? I've heard a lot of things about CEOs, and I don't know that I want to work for somebody who's, you know, who's just not a good person." And my friend Robert said, no, you should go meet him. You'll want to work for him." So I interviewed, and so the process began. And I remember leaving my first round of interviews, and I had a lot of interviews for over a month and a half.
Wait, at Pharos when you're coming in?
Oh yeah, at Pharos. I interviewed for over 15 hours, which is a whole other story. But I remember leaving that first set of interviews thinking, wow, something's different there. I don't know what it is. I can't quite figure it out just yet, but I want to be a part of it. And honestly, I didn't know, just my gut told me something was different. And fast forward about 2 months from there, and I found myself working here. And it was just the environment was almost unbelievable. I quite literally kept feeling like there's going to be another shoe that drops, right? When is the charade of this nice culture and this nice environment going to get all washed away, and then we can get down to the nitty gritty? And it took me about a year to genuinely believe that it wasn't going to change. This is what it was. And quite frankly, there was no other shoe. There was nothing that was going to drop. And the incredible thing was, I'd even had these two really unbelievable experiences. I'd been with the company about 2 months, and I found myself quite literally within from 1 hour to the next without a vehicle. I had no way to get to work. So I hatched this holy cow plan in scrambling to get a vehicle. And I called a coworker who agreed to pick me up on Monday morning. And I walked into my boss's office and I said, "I have a huge favor. I don't have a car. Long story, but I know that the company car lease is due in a week. Do you think I could borrow the car for a week? I need to go buy one. I need to get back and forth to work. I need to be able to pick my kids up, and I have no way to do any of it." And the amazing response I got, Jen, was, "Absolutely, you can have the car. Here's the keys. Do you need us to extend the lease for another month? Do you need more time so you don't have to rush into it?" And I'm not talking, it's this old company beater, right? Like, he handed me the key to BMW, and I can assure you that's not the car I ended up going to buy.
You're like, "Yes, extend it for a year. How about that?
yes, please." And then still, right? The amazing thing is I had come from this really challenging, dark environment into this environment of light. And yet, even with this first couple of months experience, I was still in disbelief. And then fast forward a few more months, and I was moving into a new house, and there had been a lot of stress, and my personal life had been quite stressful. And in a one-on-one meeting with Kevin, he said, "Is there anything we can do to help you? And what day are you moving?" "Oh, I'm moving on Thursday." And he said, "Okay, I'm going to put out an email to the company. Anybody who wants to show up on moving day, I'll have them call you or reach out to you. You can give them your address, and they can spend as much time there that day as they need to." I had 12 people show up everywhere, from anyone from the president, VPs, people in R&D, people in sales, who hauled and moved boxes from every corner of this house into my garage to expedite the movers. 2 days later, Kevin and one of the other VPs showed up, which was a Saturday, with breakfast in hand for my parents and I, because they were there for the weekend helping me, and their toolboxes. And they said, "What's the most important thing you need to get done today?" And I said, "I have a huge loft bed that I need constructed for my daughter, and I really want to get through this weekend and ensure that they have their bedroom set up so they have a place to sleep when they come back." And they spent the next 6 hours building this ridiculous 3D jigsaw puzzle, which just ended up being a comedy of errors. Honestly, I was moved to tears. I remember writing my Christmas letters that year for the staff, for the team I was on, which is the senior leadership team. And their generosity, their kindness, their heart, their spirit, their laughter, it changed my way of looking at the world, looking at how to engage and be with other people. And it was really just, honestly, it's a beautiful way to move through life. And it profoundly affected me.
Yes. Wow. It's the first time I'm hearing this. That is amazing that the CEO is going to show up at your house going, what can I help you with on a Saturday? Or even just like all your coworkers pitching in to help you in a time of need. That's amazing.
That is Pharos. That is who we are, which is really, really wonderful. I'm super fortunate.
Right. Not a bunch of words on a poster, but rather actions and kind actions at that.
Right.
People focused. Now, thank you for those stories, by the way, but how did you get involved with wellness? Your background's project management. So how did wellness fall in your lap?
Before my time, so I'm the executive administrator here, and I've had a bunch of different experience in business and office and project management. And so when I started, the person who held the position before me had proposed bringing in a yoga instructor. And they kicked it around, they interviewed a few people, and then she left to move out west. And so about 5 months after I started, somebody approached me and said, do you want to look at this? And I said, oh yeah, of course, sure, let's look at this. And so began our wellness, or rather our yoga, our weekly yoga, which we have been doing ever since November of 2013. And then Kevin and Leo from HR approached me and said, you know, we were thinking we wanted to expand yoga into like a real wellness initiative. And do you want to be a part of that? And if it works out, do you want to lead it up? And I said, sure, I'm happy to take on pretty much whatever. And so we met with a vendor who had a connection with a few of our folks here. And he was lovely. And he came in and he did this presentation. And I honestly, Jen, I had no experience with any kind of corporate wellness programs at all. But in talking to you and some other people, what I've come to realize is it was very cookie cutter corporate wellness programming. But all I can tell you, when the meeting was over, we all kind of looked at each other and said, that doesn't fit us. That doesn't work. It feels rigid. It feels contrived. And it doesn't feel like it meets who we are and what our culture is. So with that, I was tossed the hot potato and said, do something with it. And so sat down, started brainstorming different ideas, took it to Leo, and he looked at it. We both loved it. And so I started running with it.
And tell us about some of the things that you do. Why I connected with you, you have a unique approach, and it's based on, you know, started with yoga. And I think some of those themes kind of carry throughout, but talk a little bit about what you do and some of the benefits you offer, not health benefits, but, you know, like perks you offer the employees.
Yeah. I'd love to. So one of the things that we set out, which is, it's relevant in your question, because when we were framing wellness at Pharos, we were trying to figure out, what does this mean to us? And the more I peeled back the onion, the more I realized we really, really needed to meet people where they were at. And what I mean by that is we're all so incredibly different. What wellness means to me might not mean a thing to somebody else, but they sure have an idea of what wellness means to them. And so we approached this entire offering by ensuring that we touched on all the various elements that we think make wellness up: physical, spiritual, nutritional, environmental, financial, emotional, all of it. So one of our goals was to make sure that whatever we offered it holistically to the whole person, to make sure that if we didn't tickle somebody's fancy one month with one offering, maybe a month or two later, something would really, really touch them and say, yeah, this is important to me. I need to learn about this. So we started with our lunch and learns. So first of all, we do yoga, and yoga is subsidized. So anybody can come to a class once and it's free. And after that, it's $5 per class. And whatever, if we bring in enough staff to cover the cost that week, great. Otherwise, the company subsidizes the difference. And by the way, we also had another exercise program that we did for 2 years. But after 2 years, we found that the interest in it had dwindled and wasn't working anymore. So we just this past October, we sunset that program. And that was based on the same subsidized model that we did for yoga. Anybody could go. And by the way, it was in the building, so you do not have to leave the building to go to the class. We have been doing lunch and learns. And I love our lunch and learns because we touch on all sorts of different topics. We've done between 18 and 25. I've lost count. I tried to drag them all up in my mind's eye when I was thinking about this. But we've done everything from chiropractic and dermatology to olive oil tastings and essential oil experiences. We have done solar energy. We've done composting and recycling, worksite ergonomics. We've done why we sleep, right? What are the benefits of sleep? What happens when we don't sleep enough? What are some ways in which we can learn to sleep better? So we did a financial one too, right? Getting yourself into financial shape and how to track and what to do and how to help yourself. So, and we buy a fabulous lunch, and you come and you eat lunch and you enjoy yourself. You have some camaraderie, some great discussion. And then recognizing that we have 25 folks in the US who are remote, it's hard to help them with yoga, with any other fitness classes and some of the other things. So what we do at the Lunch and Learns is we offer that if they choose to have lunch with us, if you will, they choose to come and learn with us, they can buy themselves lunch and then just expense it, and the company reimburses them for it. So it's a way for us to engage some of our remote employees and staff and team members as well. And so that's a little bit more challenging, right? It's a little harder when it's not right under your nose, but we do tend to get, sometimes we get a great big handful of folks and sometimes we don't get any, but it's hit and miss with remote folks, but they always know the offer's there. And we record the sessions. So if anybody wants to call up the video later and just listen to it on their own time, they can. So that's made available to them. We have a wellness fair coming, which will be super fun. It's not like the tables and brochures. We have chair massage, we have biometric screening, and it's confidential. It's just for their own purposes and learning. We have essential oils and a fresh squeezed organic juice bar and meditation and yoga stretching, no mat required, kind of a stand up and ease some of the stress in your body from sitting at the computer all day. So that'll be really fun. And we've been planning that for a little while. We do Friday morning guided meditations for anybody who's interested. We have Friday afternoon happy hours just to bring everybody together socially, have a cocktail or non-cocktail and have a snack and just be in community with one another. We teach classes on emotional intelligence and change management. We offer composting at the office, but anybody who wants to participate in the program at home, we offer it free of charge and we pick up the bill. We pay for folks to have a day of volunteering every year or two half days at their, you know, at their leisure or their choice. And we financially support nonprofits for individuals who give their own time to specific charities of choice. And that's available to every employee as well. So we really do try to offer a nice variety. We have a few things queued up for 2018, and we'll continue with our current program structure as well. So that's a handful of things that we offer.
Yes,
some good feedback. It goes well,
right? So, what out of all of those, you know, seminar topics, the lunch and learn topics that you've had, what has been the most popular?
We have had two so far that were almost neck and neck. The first one was about 2 years ago. We brought in a mindfulness teacher. She happens to be a Buddhist teacher, a former CEO locally of a wildly successful marketing company. And she came and did a lunch and learn on mindfulness. And it was wonderful. We had folks dialing in. We had about 30 individuals from the office. We had almost half of our Rochester office. We had 7 remote folks, and we had 2 completely not connected folks who dialed in that we just happened to invite because we thought that they would be interested in it because we knew that this was something that we had had conversations with them on before. So that was a terrific turnout that we got really nice feedback on. And we just, our sleep one, actually, Why We Sleep, we just did that one last month. And that was actually a self-directed one. We tried for about 1.5 to 2 years to get an expert from a local sleep center to come in and talk to us. But they must be very busy, high in demand, because we could not manage to convince any of them to come in and spend an hour with us. So one of my coworkers who has a passion for all things mind-body, he's a voracious reader, and it was a complete fluke. One day he came over and talked to me about this book he was reading called Why We Sleep. And he said, "Oh, you've got to watch this TED talk." And so it struck me, why can't we teach this ourselves, right? We'll use the book as guidance. We use the TED talk as guidance, and we'll let the expert talk for us and through us. And we got a remarkable attendance on that. And that actually was probably our largest remote attendance. Lunch and learn. We had about 9 or 10 folks remotely, which is about not quite a third of our remote population. So that was really exciting. It was very encouraging for us.
I just love the fact that you had a conversation with someone. You're talking about kind of a well-being topic. You figured out a way that you didn't have to bring in an expert, but rather you could just have this educational opportunity and open the dialogue. So I love how you guys solution through that. And I think it just engages more employees if it's another employee kind of leading it. Sometimes better than another expert coming in.
Yeah, that made it really fun. And so that same coworker, John, and I had gone to, I don't know if you've ever heard of Google's Search Inside Yourself program. Have you? It is wonderful. So Meng, who wrote the book, he launched this program, and now they travel around the world, certainly, but they do a lot of seminars in the US. And John and I went to a two-day class in Ohio. And on our drive back, the discussion was so wonderful and robust. And we just said, you know, we have to find a way to bring this to Pharos. How do we bring this to Pharos in a way that's relatively inexpensive, non-threatening, and welcoming to people? So we spent the next 3 months rebuilding what was their 2-day program into a Pharos-esque 10-week program. And they had it broken down into segments. So we broke it down into 9 classes plus a capstone. And we had about 13 people go through that 10-week program with us, which was so much fun. So actually, we were just saying that it's time to redo that because it's been about 2 years. Mm-hmm. And we'll have to sit down and kind of re-noodle through what we would do differently. But it's fun. And the really incredible thing is I have never brought anything to Kevin and team and had them say, no, that's a bad idea. In fact, it's rare for me to bring them something and ask for permission as opposed to just decide on something, run it by a few people for gut check and go, yeah, this feels good. Let's do this.
Right. Right. And even something you said a while ago that I wrote down is that it seems as though you've just taken it from a very culture-oriented, kind of purpose-driven place, because you said at the beginning, you thought you asked the question to a group of people, what does this mean to us? What does wellness mean to us? And obviously it needed to be Pharos inspired and really have your stamp on it. So I love that, because I don't think enough people do that. I think it just kind of, it just goes, and it's very cookie cutter, goes right out of the gate the way it is without a lot of thought into it. So I love the thought and just you asking that question before it got started.
It feels good, right? I think we don't trust our gut enough.
Oh, agreed. Agreed. Yeah. Cool. Okay. So since you're not in HR, how do you actually work with HR? You mentioned Leo before. So how do you and Leo work together?
I help him when he needs it. As a one man army, he's got a lot on his plate. And quite honestly, he's a consultant who has fallen in love with being at Pharos and part of our culture and organization, that he has been planted here for going on 9 years. And so I work with him for onboarding and a few other things HR related, and wellness falls under that. And so part of that is Leo introduced, and this was part of the organization before my time, but there was an HSA incentive program in place. So when we launched the wellness program, Leo integrated it as well with the wellness program. And he runs that and I run my thing. And we find a way to work together and make it work. But it's a benefit. It's a little more along the traditional lines, I'm understanding, of what companies do. So what Pharos does is they take 50% of the IRS maximum HSA deposit allotment, and they give it to the employees. They deposit it into the employee's HSA account. 50% of that 50%, so by default, 25% of the allotment is deposited in January. And the other 25% of the IRS allotment is deposited in June. But that's based, so there's an incentive that's tied in along with that. And it's a pretty gentle incentive. It's really hard not to accomplish it, but it's optional. It's not mandatory. And it's intended to be a nudge for folks to do something that feels right and good and comfortable for them along the lines of, what does wellness mean to you? And it's quite literally check boxes. I know I sent that over to you, Jen, but I don't need, I can't.
Lots of options.
But there are lots and lots of options, as easy as drink more water. It doesn't say drink 8 waters a day. It doesn't say, you know, consume half of your, you know, body weight in ounces. It's just drink more water. So if you have somebody who drinks no water except for when they brush their teeth, and they drink one glass of water a day because that's their contribution to well-being, then we honor that. It's a trust. It is an honor system. If they say yes, I've done it and I've met the criteria, we don't double check. We don't ask for proof. We take their yes as yes. And some people say no, thank you, I don't want to participate. And we respect that. I know Leo reaches out and checks in with them to make sure they're okay. And if they need anything from us in any way, that would be helpful. So it does open up some dialogue. We haven't had anybody be resentful. I had a really good discussion with him the other day. And he said, typically they actually just say, hey, you know, I don't want to participate, or I've decided I'm good, and they leave it alone. But there's not many. There's I think 5 on average a year who opt out. They just don't participate in that part of the incentive bonus program.
But they would participate in other things, right? They'd still maybe come to lunch and learn. Are they typically, these 5 people, just non-joiners, don't want to participate? Or do they actually participate in things throughout the year? They just bypass that incentive?
Well, that's a great question. And because of confidentiality reasons, I don't have access to who those people are.
Okay.
So I don't know who they are. Leo would have that information and he might know, but they might be, right? They might be. And they might also just want to say, hey, I don't really want a checkbox, and I don't want to tell you what I do or don't do. I'm just going to go do my own thing. Yeah. So I can't give you a transparent answer on that because I don't have one. because of confidentiality.
That's a good answer.
But I will tell you, I've had nobody come to me and say, I don't like the program. You don't offer enough variety or other things. I have had people come to me and say, hey, why don't we have Zumba classes, right? That would be really fun. And my response was, because we don't have showers and folks would be really upset about not being able to grab a shower after Zumba. So then people do offer up suggestions. I get a couple, three emails, four emails a year where people say, hey, I would be interested in this, or they'll send me a link to look at something. And I always investigate it.
I think some people are just not going to join. That some people are in any population are going to be non-joiners. That's where I was just curious.
Non-joiners.
Okay. So thinking about this, what words of wisdom or what advice would you give other people who may not be wellness professionals who are starting a wellness program?
Ask questions, ask, and then ask again. Find out what matters to people. Find out what they do in their life for wellness. You know, mine might be stay on the go all the time, and somebody else's might be, I just need to sit and relax, right? So meet people where they're at and find out what matters to them and find ways to incorporate those things into wellness, and people will show up. It's that, you know, everybody, the field of dreams, right? Build it and they will come.
Right.
Build it in a way that matters to them and they'll show up in varying numbers and varying cadence on different days for different occasions for different types of things. But people will show up, and for heaven's sakes, have fun, right? Have fun, laugh, enjoy, poke at things, make yourself look silly once in a while. Just have fun. Taste things, try things, experience different things, and rule things in. Don't rule things out. We're so quick to say, no, that doesn't fit, or no, I don't want to do that, or I've never heard of that, or I'm not interested in that. I think if we can lead, but with that's interesting, let's look into it instead of I've never heard of it, let's put it on a shelf. I think we'd have a whole different experience. And, you know, finally try it. You know, you might be surprised, you might like it. And on the flip side, if you try it and it ends up being a short run or not successful, we have had unsuccessful lunch and learns where four people have showed up and we're like, oh, okay, nobody's interested in this. All right, chalk that up. Let's make a note of it and move on, right? It's okay. It's not about perpetual success. It's about embracing the learning and the failures so that you can grow and find new ways to bring to people what they really want and need.
Beautifully said. And yes, God knows we could use some more fun and wellness programs nowadays. Good advice. Susy, where can people find more about Pharos, your wellness program? I would say you, but I don't know if you want to put your contact information out there, but anything that my listeners can go find out more about you or your company.
Well, that's a great question. So they can certainly go to pharos.com, P-H-A-R-O-S. That won't tell them anything about our wellness program. We don't really advertise it. Isn't that funny? We don't put anything out there about it. My LinkedIn profile has an article that was recently published. Somebody reached out to me and wanted to chat with me about it. And it talks really a lot about what you and I have chatted about today. And through LinkedIn, if somebody wants to have a conversation or dialogue with me and they want to have a chat, I'm happy to make a connection through LinkedIn and have a conversation, a phone call, email, whatever they would like, and whatever way is comfortable for them. If they want to explore some different, I don't know, it's just some different thoughts and ideas that they had. Those are probably the two best ways.
Great. Well, I'll link those in the show notes, including the article that I read, and that's how I found you. So I'll make sure that I link those up in the show notes.
Terrific.
Susy, thank you so much for your time. I really appreciate it.
Thank you very much, Jennifer. I hope you have a great day.
One of the areas in corporate wellness where we seem to be a little bit stuck is around weight loss and our common eat less, exercise more approaches that are rather ineffective. If you're looking for a new, fresh approach that is non-diet, weight neutral, and incorporates mindfulness, look no further. And My Hungry Mindful Eating Programs and Training is a way to help employees reestablish hunger as a primary cue for eating, recognize triggers for overeating, learn to balance eating for both enjoyment and health, and helps them establish regular, enjoyable physical activity. Participants are encouraged to identify their own internal motivators and are led through a unique process that increases self-efficacy and healthy behaviors without requiring a rigid, unsustainable routine. There are quite a few ways to bring this fantastic training to your worksite, all the way from live workshops to a scalable online platform. If you'd like more information, you can just visit my website at redesigningwellness.com. Feel free to put in a contact form, and then we can set up a call to discuss more. As always, thank you so much for listening to the Redesigning Wellness Podcast.